Today, I want to provide a short video summary of the latest seminar I've taught in a course entitled Literature as History, which I'm looking at the history of Ireland through the eyes and the lives of our great writers of that period, W.B. Yeats, James Joyce, John O'Casey, etc. I'm teaching this course at Glucksman Ireland House at New York University. And this week, I want to talk about the Eumaeus episode of James Joyce's Ulysses. This is episode 16 of Joyce's great novel. And I have called this seminar Mr. Bloom versus Skin the Goat Fitzharris. Now, what I want to explain here is that this is an episode a bit like the Cyclops episode, which I spoke about a couple of weeks ago, in which Irish nationalist politics are in the focus in this chapter. Now, of course, it's not the main focus of the chapter, because the chapter is set in a cabman shelter near Bud Bridge on the River Liffey. And it's the first episode where really two of the main characters get together and have a proper conversation. Now, it's not a wonderfully warm conversation, but they do spend quality time together, I suppose you could say. This is Leopold Bloom, the main character of Ulysses, and Stephen Dedalus, a character based on James Joyce. Now, throughout the day, Bloom and Dedalus have been on different tracks, wandering around Dublin. They meet for the first time in the National Maternity Hospital on Eccles Street, where they spend some time together, although they're not really talking together because they're in a larger group, and Bloom is largely observing what's going on there. And then Bloom accompanies Stephen down to the red light district, not because he has any desire to partake of any activities down there, but because he wants to protect Stephen. He sees Stephen as someone he has a paternalistic attitude towards. And of course, in the Odyssey, the characters in the Odyssey, Stephen relates to Telemachus, who is the son of Odysseus, and of course, Bloom is Odysseus. So there's a certain father-son relationship built in here. And this is the time when they leave the Red Light District, Bloom rescues Stephen, who's getting into trouble with some British soldiers who are roughing him up. He rescues him and brings him to the cabman's shelter for a cup of coffee and a bun, a late night cup of coffee, to try and revive Stephen, who has been drinking quite a lot during the course of the day and has had a pretty rough time down in the Red Light District in Dublin's night town. So when they arrive at the cabman's shelter, Bloom mentions to Stephen that the proprietor of the cabman's shelter is supposed to be, although Bloom is not certain about this, supposed to be, rumored to be, Skin the Goat Fitzharris, one of the famous Invincibles. Now, this takes us into one of the most extraordinary and violent events of 19th century Irish history, where in May of 1882, the Chief Secretary of Ireland, who just arrived from London, Lord Frederick Cavendish, a relative of the Prime Minister Gladstone, arrives in Dublin, and he's spending time at Dublin Castle, and then he decides to walk home back to the Phoenix Park, where his residence is located. It's now the residence of the American ambassador in Dublin. And he's accompanied by the Undersecretary of the Dublin Castle administration, Thomas Henry Burke, who's an Irishman, and he's the permanent official, if you like, a senior official in the British administration at Dublin Castle in Dublin. And when they get close to a home in the Phoenix Park, they're set upon by a number of assailants who stab them using surgical knives, and both Cavendish and Burke succumb to their wounds. And this was probably the biggest blow to the British administration in Ireland throughout the entirety of the 19th century, because you had the most senior British official, the Chief Secretary for Ireland, was a member of the British Cabinet. Now, of course, there was also a Lord Lieutenant who was the representative of the Queen in Ireland at that time, But in terms of the political leadership of the administration in Ireland, the Chief Secretary was the top dog at that time. So the fact that the Chief Secretary was assassinated in this way, along with one of the most senior officials of the British administration in Ireland, this is a huge blow to the British presence in Ireland at that time. And James Joyce, who was born just 3 months before the Invincibles killed Cavendish and Burke, was obviously fascinated by this whole affair. The Invincibles were an offshoot of the Fenian movement. They were probably funded by support from Irish Americans. This was the only event, the only sort of incident they were involved in. They disappeared from history after this, but they made a very dramatic impact, obviously, by assassinating such senior figures from the British administration in Ireland. But Joyce was fascinated by this whole thing because there were 8 members of the Invincibles group. They were all eventually arrested, and 3 of them turned Queen's evidence, and 5 Invincibles were executed. And one of the Invincibles who turned Queen's evidence, Carey, was actually on his way to a new life in South Africa when he was spotted by a fellow Irish person who was on the ship with him along the South African coast, and he shot Carey. Eventually, this man, Patrick O'Donnell, was brought back to Ireland, to Britain, was tried and executed for killing the informer, Carey. So Joyce was fascinated by this whole idea of Carey's betrayal of his fellow Invincibles. And indeed, in the in an earlier episode of Ulysses, in the Lotus Eaters, episode 5, when Bloom is in the church on Weston Row, he muses about the fact that Carey, whose name he gets wrong, that Carey was a regular worshipper there and was taking communion at the church while at the same time plotting to kill the Chief Secretary. And then in the Cyclops episode, there's a reference to Joe Brady, to the execution of Joe Brady, one of the Invincibles who was put to death for his involvement in the killing of Lord Cavendish. So that's the background to the Invincibles, and so the fact that Joyce had a genuine interest in that particular affair. Joyce, as we know from other sources, was very interested in all these legal cases, and a lot of cases he followed carefully. Indeed, Adrian Hardiman, who was a former member of the Irish Supreme Court, has written a book about James Joyce and the law, in which he lists all the various cases from that time that make an appearance in Joyce's work. So he's clearly somebody who kept a close eye on what was happening in the courts, and obviously the Invincibles case was a dramatic case, which of course had a huge effect because Parnell at the time offered to resign his seat because of what happened, and Gladstone refused to accept this. Many people in Britain believe that Parnell was somehow involved with the Invincibles in this terrible murder in the Phoenix Park. And eventually a letter came out which seemed to suggest that Parnell supported the Invincibles and was involved with them. That letter turned out to be a forgery, and it was a triumph for Parnell when eventually the forger was exposed and committed suicide in a hotel room in Spain. So when we get to the Cabman shelter, we hear this discussion between Skin the Goat Fitzharris, the member of the Invincibles who had spent some years in prison and then was released and spent the rest of his life in Dublin. We don't know if he actually did own a Cabman shelter at Butt Bridge, but in any case, he has a discussion with another customer at the Cabman shelter, a man called W.B. Murphy, or Skipper Murphy, who claims to be a sailor, though we don't quite know if that's true or not, because a lot of things in this episode appear to be uncertain in the mind of the narrator, who's a rather careful character who keeps telling us that, well, this might not be true at all, this might be a totally made-up, fabricated story. In any case, Murphy makes the point to Skin the Goat that the Irish, the Catholic Irish, were the backbone of the British Army and were key to the retention of the British Empire globally. And Skin the Goat then launches into this broadside in which he outlines all the various things that Irish nationalists blame the British for economic decline, for emigration, and so forth. But then he goes on to say, but he believes that Britain is going to suffer a major setback. And he says that, you know, the Germans and the Japs are going to have their little look-in. And then he says that the Boers were the first, were the beginning of the end for England in its global reach as a major global power, and that Ireland would be Britain's Achilles heel. And that, of course, is exactly the sort of argument that inspired those who led and carried out the Easter Rising of 1916, the idea that England's difficulty was Ireland's opportunity. And here you have this idea being expressed by Joyce through the character of Skin the Goat, this former Fenian, former member of the Invincibles. Skin the Goat also says that no Irishman worth his salt would serve in the British Army. Now, of course, for much of the 19th century, maybe 20% of the British Army was made up of Irish soldiers, and means that many, many Irish nationalists from Irish nationalist Catholic backgrounds were serving in the British Army. At the time when Joyce was writing you this, is the issue of recruitment into the British Army was a big issue within nationalist Ireland, because in 1914, John Redmond, the leader of the Irish Party, recommended to his supporters that they should sign up to fight for the rights of small nations, to protect Catholic Belgium on the battlefields of the Western Front. And 200,000 Irish people served in the First World War, and 40,000 lost their lives. But of course, a minority who didn't take Redmond's advice, they ended up fighting in Dublin as members of the Irish Volunteers, part of the contingent that fought in the Easter Rising of 1916. So, in the Emmaus episode, we get a very good view of Bloom's moderate politics. Remember from previous episodes, we know that Bloom was an admirer of Arthur Griffith. He was an admirer of Parnell. He was a supporter of the Land League. So he was a moderate parliamentary nationalist with a certain fondness for the ideas that Arthur Griffith put forward in the resurrection of Hungary, the idea of Irish members of Parliament withdrawing from Westminster and engaging in passive resistance in Ireland, which is actually what happened after the election of 1918. So Bloom says to Stephen, now he doesn't directly take on Skin the Goat, but he says that he regards Skin the Goat's views as egregious balderdash. He felt that, he says that, in fact, he claims that the British are actually weak. He says the British are maybe even stronger than we think they are. So he has the kind of the same view as Arthur Griffith, the idea that, you know, Ireland is not strong enough to take on Britain through force of arms. Then he says, yet though such criminal propensities had never been an inmate of his bosom in any shape or form, he certainly did feel, and no denying it, while inwardly remaining what he was, a certain kind of admiration for a man who had actually brandished a knife, cold steel, with the courage of his political convictions, though personally, he would never be a party to any such thing. So there you have an example of Bloom as a moderate nationalist, doesn't support violence, but at the same time has a kind of a sympathy for those who have the courage and the political conviction to take up arms and to engage in a struggle for Ireland's freedom. And that, of course, was very definitely what happened after 1916, where most people in Dublin in 1916 didn't support the Easter Rising, but afterwards developed an admiration and an affection for the sacrifice that had been made by those who had led, fought, and died in the Easter Rising of 1916. And then we get probably the best outline of Bloom's moderate, sensible politics. Of course, Mr. Bloom proceeded to stipulate, you must look at both sides of the question. It is hard to lay down any hard and fast rules as to right and wrong, but room for improvement all round there certainly is, though every country, they say, our own distress included, has the government it deserves. but with a little goodwill all round. It's all very fine to boast of mutual superiority, but what about mutual equality? I resent violence and intolerance in any shape or form. It never reaches anything or stops anything. A revolution must come on the due installments plan. It's a patent absurdity on the face of it to hate people because they live around the corner and speak another vernacular, so to speak. So there you have an excellent summary of the kind of moderate nationalist position, wanting to see improvement, but focusing, in Bloom's case, a bit like Arthur Griffith, on economic issues. A bit like, say, the trade unionists from that era that we will come across in Sean O'Casey's plays in a later seminar. So, but of course, Bloom is this quintessential modernist, and he believes that a revolution must come on the due installments plan. Now, not many revolutionaries would be willing to adopt that kind of position and to believe that you can have a revolution step by step. But in fact, pragmatism and incrementalism is not the worst idea in the world of politics. And it can have, it may well be that this incremental approach is a more successful approach overall than the approach of rushing in to a revolutionary situation. So for me at least, the Emmaus episode is the episode where we get a glimpse of the Fenian tradition, which is not much covered in Joyce's work. Joyce's world was the world of Parnellite nationalism. He also obviously spotted the significance of Arthur Griffith and the Sinn Féin movement. He didn't seem to have any great interest in the Fenian movement, although his father, we know, had some interest in Fenianism at an earlier stage, but then became a devout Parnellite. So Joyce, through Bloom, expresses these moderate nationalistic views, views that got set aside, if you like, in the period after 1916, when a revolutionary ferment took hold in Ireland. But of course, in the 100 years that have passed since 1916, since 1922, since Ireland became independent with the establishment of the Irish Free State in 1922, we have seen more of an incrementalist approach to advancing the Irish cause, the kind of incrementalist approach that Leopold Bloom advocates here in the Emmaus episode of Ulysses. So that's my short summary of the last seminar. In my next seminar, I'll be talking about W.B. Yeats and the Easter Rising of 1916. So join me then.